Hello and welcome to this Institute for Government event. I'm Catherine Haddon, a senior fellow here at the Institute for Government. And today we're going to be asking a question that has many answers. What do we want from our MPs? It's a question with many answers because many people want many different things from their elected representatives. The job is to represent his or her constituents in Parliament, to get through piles of casework. It's to scrutinise legislation and appear on the media. It's to hold the government to account or perhaps to serve in government. And it's to travel from constituencies that might be hundreds of miles from Westminster. There's no guidebook or instruction manual. The only person who really decides what an MP does and how to divide their time is an MP. And because what people want and expect has evolved over time, the days of frequent late sittings and infrequent visits to constituencies might be long over. Perhaps even the days of second jobs might be over as well. And that whole row sparked by the controversy over Owen Paterson has also reminded us that that the job of an MP is quite complicated, and perhaps it's time to make that job spec a little clearer. So joining me to discuss all of this, and who knows, maybe make that specification a little bit simpler, is a great panel of people who work both in and outside of Parliament. We've got Ben Lake, who's Plaid Cymru MP for Ceredigion, first elected in 2017 and is a member of the Welsh Affairs Select Committee, as well as Plaid Cymru spokesperson for a huge range of domestic policy. Too long for me to list, I'm afraid. We've got Sir Peter Bottomley, who's Conservative MP for Worthing West, but first elected to the House in 1975 and the current father of the House. Also pleased to be joined by Marie Leconte, who's a freelance journalist and author of two books on the world of Westminster and the role of MPs, both excellent Christmas presents if you're looking. And finally, Tim Bale, who's Professor of Politics at Queen Mary in London, and most recently one of the co-authors on the book on the 2019 election as part of the general election series, also now available through certain online retailers if you are looking for an impressive stocking filler. Ben, I want to turn to you first. You've written about the impact of COVID on the work of the constituency MP, and you've been doing the job since 2017. What for you are the most important parts of the job? What do you prioritise?
Well, thank you for that question. I think it's a bit of a split personality and a split job role, as many would perhaps suspect. Parliamentary duties, whether they include raising questions in the House or indeed serving on select committees or bill committees and what have you, there, I consider those to be a very important part of the job of the MP as legislator. And I'm quite specific with that word, legislator. Holding the government to account, yes, but scrutinising legislation. I think it's something that is often overlooked in the public discourse and discussion of the jobs of MPs, because the other part of my role, and one that I believe probably demands the most on my time in a typical week, is that of a representative, very, very broadly defined, but most often or not encapsulated by casework. I think that I've been struck since 2017. You know, I don't have quite the same level of experience as Sir Peter to be able to draw historical comparisons, but I have noticed that since just 2017, the expectations on MP's office when it comes to casework, the breadth of the topics and issues that are brought to attention is quite incredible. And I would suggest that in the future, we will need to have a frank and adult conversation as a society, perhaps it begins this evening, as to whether or not we want our MPs to be more and more like caseworkers, social workers, agony aunts, or whether we want them to perhaps balance or rebalance their attentions more towards matters of state, legislating, scrutinising the government, because there is a bit of a tension, and I think it is increasingly difficult to do justice to both.
Thanks, Ben. Peter, can I come to you then? Do you recognise that? Has the job changed significantly in the time that you've been serving in Parliament?
It's always changing, but Ben is right. But it also changes whether you're on the government side or not in government, whether you're actually a member of government or not, and all those things people will take for granted, and they'll understand that anyway. there are times when being the representative is being a blue light service. You sit in your garage or ambulance station or coast guard shed until something really goes wrong, and then people pile in and something happens, often to make things less worse than it would otherwise be. So, for example, if you take the debate over Owen Paterson, a number of us came out and said what the government was trying to do was wrong. Government still won, but without the confidence, and they came back the next day and changed in the same way, without making quite so grand. In 1940, in the Norway debate, Chamberlain won the vote but lost the argument and went. So that's the blue light type thing. The questions of representative of individuals' interests or areas' interest, and it's curious that for a long time people would represent areas which were running down without doing much about it, in contrast to what happened before the 1939 war, when a number of younger conservatives, young radicals, fought for the depressed areas and started putting pressure on government to make life better in those areas. Ronnie Carpenter being one of them, Harold McMillan being another. They organised actually to change government policy on major type of things. You can argue that casework matters or doesn't matter. The view I took when I was first elected with the Labour Council, who I thought were running things badly, it was wrong that someone in social housing should come to me to get their local council to give them a proper examination of their needs. The council will do it first time and do it right. So I spend my time helping the constituent, but also helping the council to shape up their policies to take that kind of area of work away. The same thing ought to apply in dealing with the Home Office on immigration and the like. So in a way, trying to get problems to evaporate. And the last thing I'd say is this. Part of the job which an MP can do, which judges in theory can't, is to bring justice and law closer together. And to do that, I think you ought to have in Parliament, at national level at any rate, a fair number of people who might qualify as medium ranking judges. The medium ranking judges, of whom there are 1,800, presently are paid between £130,000 and £150,000 a year. We know that the poor person can be an MP, the well-off can be an MP, but what about those in the middle who have normal sort of ambitions and achievement? How much of a cut should they take to move from being head of a large comprehensive school or deputy head of a local authority to serve in the same kind of role in Parliament?
Yeah, I want to probe a bit more about pay in a bit. Maria, I want to come to you now. Ben's also already talked about the impact of the pandemic. I want to speak a little bit about that. It's something you and I have discussed before, but also the impact of social media on MPs. Has that changed the way in which they're perceived, the way in which they're doing the job?
Oh, yes, no, absolutely. And I think it's a bit of that. There's sort of two things at the same time here. So the first one, obviously, being the pandemic. And I think you see that, especially with 2019 intake MPs. And as you mentioned earlier as well, there's not one way to be an MP, and no one kind of, you know, takes you by the hand when you get elected to explain what the job is. Usually what happens is that you come in and you get basically all the hands to, you know, show you how to set up an office, how to do your job, etc. That didn't effectively happen because they came into Parliament and then the pandemic happened nearly immediately afterwards. So they basically had to sort of like create the job for themselves. And quite often that's meant a job that's been very, very rooted in the constituency, also helped by the fact that a lot of them, you know, are in marginal seats anyway, so probably would be more constituency focused as it is. So yeah, very focused on that. And what I found quite interesting is perhaps more on the Tory side and the Labour side, there's a it feels quite transactional from some of them, nearly sort of US-like kind of, you know, well, you know, you elected me and you will get that bridge, or, you know, I said I would build that underpass and that's getting built, which I think we didn't used to see as much in politics before. But then, yeah, the broader thing as well, I think the context is also that social media, I think, had been individualising MPs quite a lot over the past of like 5 to an extent 10 years, in that, you know, for a very long time, if you were a backbench MP, no, to be blunt, no one massively cared, you know, about kind of what you were doing. You were elected because of the party you represented, and then you sort of did your thing. And, you know, the local paper may care a bit, but that was sort of that. I think Facebook, to an extent, but especially Twitter, has changed that. So that means that you can now have any opinions on any topic. You can mark yourself as saying, actually, you know, I'm a campaigner on like X or Y issue, or I'm an X wing of the party, have, you know, that ideology, etc. So you can very much create, I think, a profile for yourself and see yourself, arguably, I think, as more individual. Sorry. And I think you sort of see that in even political coverage. And we saw a lot of that during the Brexit years as well. Of every time there was a vote, you know, you'd have the Mirror, the Guardian, all the papers saying, actually, you know, click on that tool and we'll show you exactly how you MP voted on this and this and that. So yes, I would say that the rule is changing in the sense that MPs, no matter, you know, whether they are secretaries of state or lowly backbenchers, are kind of more their own person. And I think you see that quite a lot as well with the 2019 intake MPs, both Labour and Tory, already breaking the whip quite often, which feels quite unusual for, you know, for an intake that's still very fresh.
Yeah, Tim, coming to you, public perceptions then, is that true? Are we seeing that the view of an MP has changed quite a lot and quite recently?
It's difficult because actually there's less data than you would imagine to allow us to form a picture of what's happened over time. We have, however, got some quite interesting data from a survey that was taken both of MPs and of voters about 5 years ago as to the role of an MP. And what you see there is some broad agreement and then some very, very big disagreements between MPs and voters. So actually, when it comes to the sort of top ranked role, as far as both voters and MPs are concerned, it's actually taking up and responding to issues and problems raised by your constituents. So there's fairly broad based agreement on that. Over half of voters think that that's the most important role, and actually even more MPs think that that is the most important role. So that really, I think, comes back to what Sir Peter was saying a little bit earlier. There's quite a big difference, however, between how much they value the role in legislation. So I think it's about 16% of MPs put that as the top thing that they should be doing, but only around 7% of voters think that that's the most important thing for an MP to be doing. So there's a big difference there. There's also a big difference when it comes to being active in the constituency. Now, it's around 8% of MPs think that that's important. So I guess that's showing yourself, opening schools, fates, that's that kind of thing. Whereas for voters, that's much more important. It's nearly 30% of voters put that as the number one thing that MPs should be doing. Interestingly, and this comes back to something that Marie was saying, and I wonder if there might be a little bit of economy with the actualité when it comes to this, as far as MPs are concerned. There was a question in there about maintaining a national media presence. And apparently only, let me just check the figure so I get this right, apparently only 0.6% of MPs thought that was the most important thing for them. And 0.7% of voters thought that was the most important thing. But I suspect with some MPs, that's actually rather more of a role they take seriously than perhaps they're admitting.
Yeah, that's very interesting, actually. I can see Ben and Peter are both looking askance at that. Peter, do you recognise those sorts of descriptions? Does that tie with your experience? And when you talk, do you talk to new intake of MPs when they join about what it's like, what you think the role is?
If anyone makes the mistake of asking me a question like that, I'll ask them if they want a drink and get them talking, because the last thing anyone seriously wants to hear is what an MP has to say until they're dead and buried. And to those who are thinking of politics, I recommend Julian Critchley's book called A Bag of Boiled Sweets, which is what he suggests is the only thing you're allowed to accept now as a Member of Parliament in terms of hospitality. I think, so if I just go back to the first question, what I would have intended to have said is, who's your circle in Parliament or National Assembly or whatever? There are people like me who tend to work across party bounds on all sorts of issues that matter. So whether it's leasehold reform or it's it was trying to get in front seatbelt wearing back in 1982, or whether it's trying to get possibility of abortions legal for people in Northern Ireland. Those things only work if you go across party boundaries and you actually accept that from the extreme left of the Labour Party to the centre right, that their party extends to the centre-right, and to Tories it goes from extreme right to centre-left. And within that area in between is normally where the rudder and the mast are. So you can throw a government out and you can keep many of the MPs anyway and go on working for things which basically need long-term attention. It's also worth remembering that in terms of legislation, nearly everything that's passed in Parliament now was fought about 5 years ago on the previous bill on the subject. So even though an amendment might have been lost 5 years ago, it may come back now, and we're seeing that over some of my residential leasehold type things. if an MP says, because they've got 30 or 40 or 20 years experience, they can tell you what it's been like, they're wrong. First of all, if they're that old, their memory's gone. And secondly, the issues change or the personalities change. And if you're in an area where you have a minority government, as we did from roughly 77 to 79 with the Lib-Lab Pact, or you had the instability of Theresa May's period, or you had from 2010 to 2015, where David Cameron creatively got the Lib-Lab Pact coalition going properly, much to everyone's surprise, that's very different from when you have a majority of 80 or 120 or whatever. You also need to be able to play a waiting game, unless you're a whip, in which case your job is just week to week. You aren't interested in long-term policy. And I think that to have this kind of discussion without bringing the whips in and their influence and who those sort of people are, you'll give people an idea that MPs can decide what they're going to do. Those who have seven jobs as ministers don't have to decide which way to vote. They're told, and they will. And the PPSs will as well, unless they resign. It's only for the people in the middle who have a degree of discretion that we can decide for ourselves, I will vote with the government, tell them they're wrong, or vote with the government because I think they're right, or abstain, or vote against, and whether I do that noisily or quietly. And those are, again, the kinds of things which most outside observers don't really understand.
Tim.
Interesting. There is research on what voters think of MPs who do refuse to toe the party line, who do dissent. And interestingly, it shows that voters like that. They regard it not only as a way of sort of boosting the MP's profile, so it gets more name recognition among voters, but they also like it because it signals, as far as they're concerned, trust and integrity. So voting against, while, as Sir Peter says, is impossible, basically, if you're on the payroll, if you are a backbencher, then it may be something that actually does you some good electorally, or at least in terms of the way that your voters think of you. Whether they repay that when it comes to polling day is another matter, of course.
Yeah. Marie, did you want to come in on this?
Yes, I did. So I was wondering, although there's not an adjacent issue here on basically saying what do we want from our MP staffers as well. So it kind of strikes me that a lot of what we're talking about of saying, you know, basically, yeah, the whips are just telling the MPs what to do and what to vote on, and there's not quite enough time to do everything in the constituency and everything in Parliament, etc. As Ben was saying, aren't a lot of the solutions here basically saying actually we should probably give MPs a lot, like considerably more budget basically for their staff. So be that, you know, if they need people to properly, you know, policy experts who can kind of chew on that stuff and help the MP make the best decisions, or enough caseworkers, because I know if you talk to kind of MPs, and especially inner city constituencies, they say basically all of the money on my staff goes to caseworkers in the constituency. I have no one in Westminster, like one part-time person, so I feel I'm not scrutinising the government or doing the lawmaking bit of the job as well as I know I could. So just kind of wanted to throw that out there. Staffers, more money.
Peter, I see you wanted to come back in. Ben, I am going to come back to you on that question as well.
I think we should pay enormous tribute to caseworkers, especially over times like Afghanistan, when they were run all 24 hours a day by people hiding behind a rock in desperate, desperate need. And there are times, even for people in this country, whose circumstances become indescribably unbearable. And it's our staffers often, together with the MP, who pick them up and prop them up and take the emotional burden of that as well. On researchers, I would bluntly ban researchers full stop. An MP should not speak on something they don't know anything about. And if they want to learn about it, read the mainstream media. Don't send somebody off to go and do a part-time MA in the library and come forward with 14 pages, of which they're able to use five paragraphs if they get 2.5 minutes to speak later on in a debate.
Ben, is that reasonable? You're a spokesperson for a huge range of domestic policy. You're quite a small party. How important are your researchers, and do you need more, not less?
Well, I think that most MPs' offices would welcome an extra pair of hands, especially on the point that Peter made on caseworkers, because the past 2 years in particular have taken quite an emotional toll, I would suggest. And in the early weeks of the pandemic, I remember that the phone was off the hook, the inboxes at one point, you know, it was refusing to load properly because such were the with the volume of emails coming in, and we are dealing with people who are in desperate situations and understandably quite anxious and emotional. And there is a relationship that develops over time. I'm sure that Sabita would also have a certain number of constituents who have fallen on some bad luck, and you get to know them quite well. And the caseworkers also become effectively a friend on the other side of the phone when oftentimes there is nobody else to call. And so I do think that there is a very good case for looking at the staffing budget when it comes to constituency offices and caseworkers. When it comes to the researchers, I have quite a degree of sympathy actually with Peter's position on this. I do think that if we are to have MPs deliberating, debating, tabling amendments potentially, and scrutinising government decisions, then having them engaged and informed on the matters of the day, whatever that may be, is incredibly important, because it is one thing for an MP to stand on their feet and read a pre-prepared speech on a subject that they have no idea about. It's another for them to actually debate and engage in the debate from an informed position. Now, perhaps I might not go quite as far as a complete ban, but if we were to discuss changes to the budget and increases to the staffing budget for MPs, I do think that it is something for us to pursue, that it is hypothecated perhaps more towards caseworkers, and there is a particular job structure and job description that could, so that MPs would be able to make greater use of parliamentary resources, or sorry, finances, to employ more caseworkers, which should then free up a lot of their time to do the reading and to do the other aspect of the role of engaging in important matters of the day.
I'm just going to bring in a question that we've got, which you can all ponder, because I know Tim wants to come in again. But you can ponder this question and see if anyone wants to take it on. Somebody's asked, how has the changing role of local government affected the amount of casework that MPs receive? Has the devolution of some services to the local level changed what MPs have to do? I suppose, the other aspect is sort of problems with social care and where services are actually falling over. Has that increased the amount of casework? Ponder that, and if anyone wants to sort of come back on that, that'd be great. Tim, in the meanwhile, you wanted to come back on one of the points.
I just wanted to talk a little bit about research. It's worth saying that, of course, the two main parties especially do have a kind of centralised research service that does supply their MPs with briefings if they want them, and of course there is the Parliamentary Library, which does an incredible job as well. So it isn't necessarily the case that MPs need individual researchers. They could give those up in favour of employing more people in casework, as both our MPs have suggested. In terms of the changes to local government and whether they've eased the burden or not, I suspect that's not true. I suspect actually, because of the way that the state has, to some extent, for good or ill, retreated since the 1980s, there is simply more hardship, to be honest, more people falling through more cracks. And that means more people will contact their MPs. And unfortunately, in some ways, the more successful MPs are in actually solving people's problems, then the more work they are bound to generate, because word of mouth gets around that the MP can help people out. And understandably, they will then go to their MP, particularly if they find that they're frustrated by the bureaucracy of local government and other organisations.
Peter.
Well, my wife was a member of Parliament for 21 years. In fact, when she said she was going to stop, she thought that was long enough. I said, don't say that in my constituency, because I've been there rather longer. Her post bag was about three times greater than mine. And it wasn't because of the characteristics of her constituency. I think it's because, first of all, she's very efficient at responding. And secondly, people tend, in general, to look to women as being more interested and more responsive than men. And I think it'd be interesting to do a study whether that's just my hypothesis or whether there's something to back it up. I think often women do find themselves being asked to do more things, doing more things, and getting a greater degree of correspondence, to which they give more attention than many men do. I think that the question about local government, I don't think that would, in a study, show a demonstrable difference. And even if Tim were right, which he may be, about state withdrawing from things, I'm not sure there's much evidence they have on balance, I don't think that's what generates MPs' post bags or emails or people coming to you. I think that often it's publicly run services where things either slip through the cracks or they seem unfair or unresponsive that matters. And here, incidentally, just in praise of people doing housing in different ways, in my present constituency, 2/3 of it's in Worthing, which has pushed its social housing to Worthing Homes, an arm's length charity. The Arran part still have directly run social housing, and each work equally well and far finer than the London Borough of Greenwich did when I was the MP there for 22 years. So I think that different systems can work equally well or possibly badly, and that the quality of people leading services and giving effective devolved power to their own staff make it possible for them to bring the human touch in, which otherwise will come to the MP or the MP's caseworker to say, please reread this. And by the way, did you see what they said in the second paragraph? That seems to be the determining fact. You know, give them what they need.
Ben, I think you wanted to come,
Yes, just very briefly to add, of course, that in Wales, Scotland, Northern Ireland, you also have the devolved legislatures as well. And that has perhaps on initial reflection, you'd think that it would help the postbag of the MP in those areas, because members of the Welsh Parliament, Scottish Parliament, or Irish Assembly, what have you, to undertake inquiries on a whole range of policy areas. However, in practice, I think that we find that the public's understanding of the constitutional situation isn't always that good. And I think, given that, you know, the Member of Parliament as a as an office, as an individual, has quite a long pedigree, and often if there is a concern or a problem, it is to the Member of Parliament that people go to, even if that particular problem relates to a devolved area of policy. Health is a, you know, a big one. And then the individual MP has that quandary of, well, do you take the approach of, well, I should be advising and informing individual that actually they shouldn't come to the Member of Parliament, they should rather write to their members of the Welsh Parliament or to their county councillor, if it may be the case. More often than not, I'm perfectly happy to admit, you tend to think, well, they are in a bit of distress, I shall help them, but that perhaps doesn't do any good in the long run for people and the MP's postbag.
Marie, I want to just explore a bit more about social media, because we've got a few questions coming in about that. And we've also got the Commons Committee on Standards, who've now produced their recommendations for reform, which has obviously been a big focus for the last few weeks. One of the things that they've talked about is an additional principle of respect being added to the existing seven Nolan principles, and also recommended that MPs should be banned from making an unreasonable or excessive personal attack in any medium. Do you think this change is necessary? Is there something about MPs' social media presence that, you know, has changed the sort of the political discourse?
Oh, yes and no. I think the main problem is basically that all of this is so new that we kind of, there are no rules at the moment. We have no idea basically what's right and what's wrong. So I remember a few weeks ago, actually, there was a debate on Twitter over, so I think the idea was, should an MP be allowed to block someone else on Twitter, especially if they're a constituent? And that was genuine. I mean, and I know it sounds like a very small thing, but it was really interesting because actually everyone came up with a slightly different reasoning for saying, you know, yes, it's fine, no, it's not fine, no, it's fine only if X, etc. And I think that's kind of symptomatic of a wider problem, which is that we have no idea how members of parliament are kind of expected to act on Twitter. And obviously, I think more recently we had Nadine Dorries talking quite a lot about trolling, and then some people obviously pulled up predictably some tweets where she'd been less than kind to, I think, journalists she disliked, etc. And so, yeah, I mean, I would say I think it's arguably a good thing to have a conversation on this and perhaps even have some rules of saying, actually, you know, we're deciding now, Twitter's been around for about a decade. We've now decided that we should actually say, well, you know, you can do X, you can't do Y. But I'm not entirely sure who really gets to decide that and how that's actually going to play out.
We had a question.
I'll ask Marie what her Twitter handle is.
It's at Young Bulgarian.
Bulgarian, but Bulgarian is supposed to be someone who doesn't know that they're vulgar, so you can't do that. So you turn yourself into a French philosophical knot.
I have.
I think just coming back, I once was told I'd got some technology award for being an MP who had a Twitter account, but I got the award for never using it, which I think is a bit backhanded. I think the idea of respect being something others can judge is not right. My father told me when he was a minister's assistant private secretary in 1948, he was authorised to reply, "Dear Snooks, your unexpected letter to the minister has been read. I'm to inform you it's not been selective for substantive response." If someone then complains that that's a lack of respect, I hope any judge would say it's a perfectly reasonable response. There's no duty to respond to people. If someone sends me their 17th letter in a fortnight, having done the same thing in other fortnights before, I ought to be able to say to them, "You can go on writing, but don't expect a reply." Or if someone won't politely end a telephone conversation, I can say to them, "You can go on speaking. I won't say another word." I then put the phone in the waste paper basket and go off to another room and do some more work and leave them to it. Now, that might be judged by some as lack of respect. I regard it as appropriate.
Great.
So I don't disagree, but then I think you could make the opposing argument of saying, especially in the case of social media, so Facebook and Twitter, quite often MPs will be using that for constituency matters and, you know, constituency breaking news or saying, you know, if a road is flooded or whatever else, you know, that they will first and foremost put that information out on Facebook and Twitter. So again, I think there's a bit of a pickle here, which is quite interesting, of saying, does that mean that, you know, if a person is abusive, you can cut them off from the channel in which that person would usually find out about what happens in their village or their town, etc. So, and I'm saying that, you know, I don't actually have an answer to this, but that's the question, I think.
Ben.
Thank you. And a thought that just occurred to me in recent weeks, I've received quite a few pieces of correspondence, whether through social media or indeed via email and actually the post, in which people take great offence at the fact that I perhaps don't agree with their point of view. And that seems to have, I haven't really quite reflected on it until very recently, because it's quite bizarre really that somebody would expect an MP to always agree with them. Likewise, it is unreasonable for an MP to assume and to expect the constituents to agree on what they're doing. You know, that is part of the debate. It's an important part of democracy, I would argue, that exchange of opinions can be had in a polite and civil manner. But it is quite striking that, especially on social media, if you are to disagree with somebody's view or point of view, then you are then chastised and indeed sometimes demonised. And that has been there since 2017, certainly my experience. You are the big bogeyman if you don't agree with everything, single thing that somebody puts to you in a tweet. What is now quite interesting is that has percolated through to the more typical traditional pieces of media of correspondence, you know, the post and email. But it is quite funny, some of the responses you can elicit if you just politely disagree.
I'm just going to bring in two of the questions that we've had. George asked earlier, social media is being toxified and weaponized by some in politics. Shouldn't we have a basic social media charter for MPs? I'm leaving that there as more of a comment because we've discussed that a little bit. But also just going to what you were saying there, Ben, we had, if I can find it again, somebody asking, is there more that, yeah, do we think that MPs do a good enough job of explaining to the public what their job is and why it matters? Tim, I know you wanted to come back, but anyone wants to come back on that point? And then at some point, we're going to have to turn to pay, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it is a tricky one because there is no, as people often say, job description for MPs. There have been a few attempts to nail one down, but it is quite difficult, but it is such a varied role. One thing I did want to say, and it comes off the back actually of what Ben was saying, is that I think one of the great things about our MPs, and you know, there's enough bad said about them, so let's say something good, is that, as you know, as far as I know, and as far as anyone has ever done research on this, they really do not discriminate when it comes to helping people. On the basis of whether those people have voted for them, you know, whether they disagree with them on particular issues. And I think that is an incredibly valuable part of our system and something that we shouldn't forget, actually, that despite the toxification, despite the polarisation, it remains true that if people write to their MPs, whatever their views, and they need help in terms of casework, then MPs and their staff will give them that help.
Yeah, Marie, you want to come back in again? I've just got a comment I'm going to read out, also anonymous. Given the constituency case workload and need for more office staff, should impartial public servants be employed to ensure a minimum standard of service to constituents? Which I guess is a follow-up to this debate about whether or not the amount of time that MPs are devoting to constituency, maybe quality rather than quantity, is important in terms of constituency. But I'm not sure how you would do that. But ponder that one. Come to it if you want to. If not, we've got loads more to talk about. Marie, you wanted to come back.
Oh, yes, just on the point of saying, actually, should MPs do a better job of explaining what they do for a living? I think that's actually something that's been under discussed a bit. And the example I would use is they work for you. The idea being that, you know, thanks to social media, especially, I think, in the internet in general, I think there are a lot more people who are sort of paying attention more to what happens in Parliament because, you know, stuff goes viral all the time. And, you know, some votes which actually were not that important will be made to look on Facebook, like, you know, basically the Conservative government have banned puppies forever, etc. But there's kind of like, you know, a big problem there, which is that actually Parliament is very opaque and the way it works can be very confusing. And as you see, a site like They Work For You, which I'm sure Ben and Peter will be very well acquainted with, which says, you know, your MP voted for X, you know, strongly in favour of X, strongly against Y. But which has been criticised kind of time and time again for saying actually, you know, it can be quite misleading and it will count, you know, things like, for example, every single line of basically what is in the budget as separate votes, or, you know, will not count when there's something goes without a vote in the chamber, etc., etc. And then obviously, so I've actually interviewed the founder of They Work For You before, and his argument was actually saying, we're just trying our best here, and, you know, we're not Parliament, we're just volunteers effectively trying to make the public understand what happens in Parliament because no one else is doing it. So I do think there's kind of an issue there of, around, I think, the broader expectations of MPs, is also as a first step, making sure, like, you know, someone somewhere should be making sure that actually the public, if it wants to, should have a better sense of actually what does happen in Parliament and how laws are made.
Peter, I think you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I think the job of those who do They Work For You is incredibly difficult, and they don't do it very well. I just looked myself up, and apparently my views were on bovine tuberculosis in cattle is one of the important things, and I could tell them five or six other things which are running issues that affect large numbers of people that are reasonably current. But I think they've got a difficult job. I think that describing what an MP does is a bit like describing what a parent does. And I think what you ought to do is to aim to be a good enough parent or a good enough MP. And for a parent, I could run through five things which don't make you a perfect parent, but, you know, get your child to school on time each day, having the right clothes, having had breakfast, have another meal with another household at least once a fortnight, have one after school activity, be on the best possible terms with the child's other parent. If in doubt, the children's interest comes first. I can do the same thing for MPs and say, if in doubt, the national interest or the constituency interest comes first, but don't make it only the constituency interest, in which case our defence policy would be determined by whether the Marines' music school should be in Deal or not. I think there are more important things than that. So I think that you also need to realise that MPs vary from being a 25-year-old new person who may be very important, like William Pitt, who became Prime Minister, or a 70-something-year-old who becomes Prime Minister like Winston Churchill, having been through four or five different parties. You know, if the idea of respect to your own party mattered, that wouldn't have been allowed. We wouldn't have had him in 1940. So try not to push MPs into something which provides the same kind of shape decoration on every cake. Allow for space. But if your MP isn't good enough, change the MP. Don't change the terms or what you think about them because your MP may have slipped up or may be a bad hat.
Okay. Oh, I want to ask about pay. You mentioned at the beginning, you know, a big impact, it depends where you've come to. And just to say, we've got quite a few questions coming in on this. One says, do you think that constituents want MPs that complain about the salary when they receive it's more than three times the UK median? There were some others below. I'll sort of come to those. I mean, Peter, do you think that there needs to be some kind of variation? Is that what you're saying in terms of the level of pay? Does that mean that, right, so you wouldn't think that, say, you having such a long experience of being in the job, you would get paid much more than, say, Ben coming in having done four years? It's not like another system.
I should pay less because I don't have a big mortgage. I don't have expensive dependent children. I've got a working wife. There's every reason why I should do the thing for free, and I probably would. That's not the point. And what people also don't realise is that, first of all, I've been making the same speech on this since the 26th of July, 1977. when it was put to Enoch Powell, who pointed out there were more candidates than places and didn't suggest the terms were at least adequate. The point was put back to him by Mike Thomas, a good Labour MP. Were you to lower the terms so you had exactly the right number of MPs, would the right honourable gentleman then be satisfied with the calibre of his colleagues? He remained in his place, muttering into his waistcoat something about the impertinence of those who have not been here for very long. I also think the MP's pay shouldn't change between general elections. You should stand for election on a rate of pay, and that shouldn't change for inflation or anything else until there's another election. The issue, just to repeat for those who was sort of thinking about something else when I first said it, is not whether the well-off person can be an MP, a successful novelist or someone who owns a business, or the poor person who's been used to being a Methodist minister, or they've been out of work, or they've been somewhere at home with caring responsibilities. It's the people in the middle. And why do we pay general secretaries of my trade union at 50% more than members of parliament? Why do we pay the deputy chief executive of my local authority 50% more than the member of parliament? Are we saying that these people, if they've decided to be an MP for 5 or 10 years, should stop? And the comparison which people insult me about is that if my GP, my family doctor, became an MP, I think they ought to be able to be a general practitioner in politics at the same rate of pay as a general practitioner in medicine and go back to being a general practitioner in medicine, which would require them to be able to keep their license up. So the idea you can ban second jobs, even for those who weren't ministers, strikes me again as hardly opening your mind before you start talking. So I think that essentially make being a member of parliament something which a normally successful professional person can do, recognizing that it is 2 to 3 to 4 times higher in pay than the median earnings. If you look to when MPs were first paid money, and of course all the arguments were, if you pay money, they'll do it for the money. Not true, wasn't true, just excluded people, that they were then paid, I think, 6 times the median earnings. I'm not saying that I would give up at lower rates of pay. I wouldn't. I'd do it for free. I don't ask for it for myself. I don't have needs. But I do want to have a system where those middle successful people can come in without a significant change to their standard of living.
Ben, I mean, this has obviously been a very live debate in the country at large, second jobs and also to some extent, you know, MPs pay. What's it been like in, you know, in the House in the last few weeks? What's the mood like? And have views been changing, or, you know, is Peter making some sort of strong points there?
Well, the mood has been, I suppose I'd say quite fluctuous past fortnight and quite tense. The you know, the fundamental question is quite an important one for us to deliberate on, and I think that it's good that we are having the debate as to perhaps broadly speaking, what should the MP be doing, and then more specifically whether or not they are able to undertake other forms of employment at the same time. From my point of view, I think the time commitment perhaps is the big factor. And this again, we come back to the quandary we identified at the beginning as to the role of an MP can vary quite significantly. The expectations on an MP perhaps in a rural setting, very well, hundreds of miles away from London, you at the stroke of a hat, you need to factor in either at least 8 to 10 hours travel time every week. Yes, you can do emails on trains, you can take a few phone calls if the signal is adequate, but by and large it ties you to a very limited range of functions as an MP. Compare that to a member of parliament who perhaps lives nearer to parliament in London, in one of the London boroughs, then of course that sort of time constraint isn't the same on them. But if I was to say that perhaps I'm being I'm missing something here, but I find it very difficult for the last 2 years to even entertain pursuing another form of employment at the same time as being a member of parliament, just because the time pressures and the responsibilities upon me as a member of parliament were so great. Now, I do have sympathy, however, to the point of view that has been made that we do not want to throw the baby out of the bathwater, and we want to make sure that those who stand for election and those who serve as members of parliament have a wide range of experiences, and in that endeavour of trying to assemble a parliament that is as reflective of society as possible, right? And in that, to that regard, I think we've already heard arguments being made that those in certain professions that will require them to maintain their professional qualifications, whether they are barristers, whether they are doctors. It seems to me that people are quite happy for that exemption to be made. And I think what probably we will land in the end, if we manage to reach any consensus, will be that there is a principle that being a member of parliament will take up the vast majority of your time. However, there will be a certain list of professions or vocations that society as well as parliament would benefit from being included in a list of exemptions. I've named a few, but I'm sure there are others. That's probably where I think we should be pursuing as a country. That's where I think we'll probably end up. We then, however, get into the tricky question of money and whether or not, how much should members of parliament, if they are to be allowed to continue in second professions, how much of that, remuneration can they receive? But that's one I'm afraid to say I haven't quite worked it out myself yet.
Sure. Tim and Maria, I know you both want to come in. Just to say, because you mentioned diversity, we've got a couple of comments on or questions on that. But if anyone wants to come, this one's directed to you, Ben and Sir Peter. Could you comment on the first past the post electoral system and whether it enables the most representative candidates to be elected to the Westminster Parliament? And there was another question, if I can just find it. Martin George says, leaving aside pay, how do we ensure that across elected MPs, we have a representative balance of expertise and interest that reflects the interests of the country as a whole? Is this desirable? And if not, why not? Tim, I think you had your hand waving at me first, and then Marie, I'll come to you.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting when we talk about MPs with experience, we're often talking about, you know, professional experience or business experience. But actually, if you look at the question of representation in the House of Commons, the biggest lack in some senses is people in ordinary working class occupations. And that has got worse over the years as Labour has become less reliant on trade unions, for example. So really, if we want people to undertake economic activity or to have undertaken economic activity in order to make the House of Commons rather more representative, then we really ought to be talking about people who drive bin lorries rather than necessarily people who earn, you know, rather large amounts of money as part-time directors or as consultants. Interestingly, there has been some research on this by Phil Cowley and Rosie Campbell, who did some survey experiments on this to find out what the public thought about this. There wasn't really much evidence that the public bought the idea that MPs carrying on second jobs helped them understand society better. But there were some differences. The public were much more sensitive when those jobs were very, very high paying than they were when those jobs, only earned a small amount of money. And they are also very unsympathetic to things like part-time directorships, unless they were of a company which that MP had started. They were actually quite keen on entrepreneurs being allowed still to run their own businesses and run their own companies. In fact, they were even keener on that than they were on people carrying on doing their profession like law or medicine. So the public have got actually quite nuanced attitudes on this. It's not all bad. And I don't think we necessarily need to go so far as both our MPs are saying, as to ban all second jobs, because I think the public do recognise that there are some benefits. They're not completely convinced that they're huge. And it, as I say, it does depend on quite how much those benefits mean in terms of finance to the MPs concerned.
Yeah, Marie, it does seem to be coming down to, doesn't it, a debate between whether it's about experience and skills that you bring to the role of MP versus a way to make money.
Yes, well, I think so. The point I was going to make, it's sort of adjacent to that. And I think apologies for like getting a bit philosophical, but I do wonder if the tension at the centre of this is not actually the difference between what do we want from our MPs and what do we want from our House of Commons, in that, you know, I think you could quite easily argue that the best possible House of Commons we could have would be a mix of actually, you know, people who do have part-time jobs, be that very highly paid or what they used to do beforehand and stuff, or people who are sort of, you know, born and bred in SW1 and just work in politics 7 days out of seven, but a mix also of, you know, obviously like ideologues and people who are just very focused on local, you know, bread and butter issues, etc., etc. So you kind of need a really rich mix, basically, of members of parliament in order to make a House of Commons that is as good as it can possibly be. But at the same time, every time we do end up debating things like this, it kind of ends up being like, actually, what do we want from each single individual MP, with the idea that they should all sort of be the same in every set of rules we develop. So be that on second jobs or pay or et cetera, you know, everything else, and would end up basically not working because it kind of assumes that every MP should sort of be the same type of MP. So again, I think the problem I think here is micro and macro of what we want from individual MPs is not quite the same as what we want from the House of Commons as a whole. But yeah, again, apologies if this is getting a bit esoteric. It's
fascinating. We like a bit of esoteric. It is, you know, 10 to 5, so it's worth it. Peter, did you want to come in?
Yeah, one comparison I always go back to, journalists, even if you take a subset of journalists, those who do the sketches, the politics sketches, they're very different. You know, you had Patrick Kidd, who's brilliant at the long view on sport, Quentin Davis, who's quite good at reviewing plays. You've got John Crace, who's in an area of his own. You can't draw up a specification saying who do we want to do our diaries. And Marie and her accurate descriptions of what goes on in Parliament would stand as the inclusiveness, both not being English to start with and having the ability to make jokes in French and in English contemporaneously, which I think is quite smart. I once tried that. I think the... First of all, a very serious point. Some people only vote for Conservatives, only vote for Plaid, only vote for Lib Dems. Others will say, I'm willing to float or use my judgment. If those people predominantly chose the better candidate from those in front of them, or their first two choices, you'll find parties saying, which is the better candidate? Who will get those votes from thinking people? Not just the loyalists, who I don't regard as unthinking because they're very important to have them, but if on balance, each MP came from a party locally who selected and nationally who put them on the list, if that's the way it works, who said this is a better kind of person, you'll end up with better MPs, full stop, across the board. Let's try to remember that. Secondly, just to take something out of Tim's mouth, we tend in our country to assemble our coalitions within parties before an election rather than afterwards. Most countries, especially with national PR systems, going for government forming, coalition forming afterwards, where normally, instead of first past the post, it's last past the post. The biggest minority party buys the smallest minority party because they're normally the cheapest. And you end up with sometimes chaos and sometimes other things. Last thing, just to keep in people's minds, try to remember the benefits of the stability of lasting parties. If you look at the demagoguery, or if Nigel Farage doesn't mind me giving him that compliment, of getting people into the European Parliament for UKIP, they were... Obviously, a lot of people who had to apologise saying I said I couldn't get elected, but I was wrong. They did get elected. But they were complete shambles in general, or at least a number of individuals. Try to go for some degree of stability with parties who do have a lasting interest in what's going on, rather than the flashes in the pan. Because one thing you can say about our politics is we tend not to have extremists in our parliament for long and in large number. And avoiding the extremists avoids a lot of other problems which would keep the institution of government going for much longer than it might otherwise do.
Thank you. Ben, I just wanted to turn to you. There's a question from George saying, parties choose people. There are thousands of people who would make excellent MPs, but the UK doesn't do indie MPs, independent MPs. Why is this? I mean, more a question for you of like, you know, what the motivation for becoming an MP, the journey to becoming an MP, you know, does it feel very much about you as the individual versus you as part of the party? How does it, how's the balance work?
I think that there is a temptation, I'm sure, on occasion for an MP to think that it's something that they have done when it comes to elections, and that they have managed to win a seat because of their own inherent strengths and what have you. However, I think that on balance, it is very difficult for us to elect independent MPs. Not perhaps because the electorate are inherently opposed to having MPs who are not affiliated to a party, but more because it is very difficult during an election period, even if it is a scheduled election and a candidate is able to muster a campaign over 2 years or what have you. It is very difficult for them without a party and without all the resources, both financial and also in terms of people, to get their name, their message, their values out there. And so perhaps if you were to, I remember my grandparents saying that certainly in rural parts of Wales, the big event was the hustings, and every village would have the hustings where all the candidates would attend, sometimes for 10 minutes, just so that they give their pitch and then they go to the next village. And they were able, I suppose, to take a temperature and the measure of the candidate for themselves. These days, those sort of events don't happen as much. You do have a few hustings. So you are then dependent on the leaflets, the door knocking, the campaigning and the canvassing. You are only really able to do that with the help and support of the party behind you. So I think that probably explains why we have so few examples of independent MPs. And then the few examples that we do have in recent history, I think have tended to have won as an independent following a career in Parliament or indeed some sort of celebrity. I think that probably then is the exception that proves the rule.
And then finally, and I guess there's a question for all of you, I'll come to each of you in turn, and we've only got a few minutes left. Ben, starting with you, I mean, you say it's been a very difficult few weeks, you know, inside Parliament. We now have the Standards Committee report on suggested reforms. We have a route forward. Do you think that this has been a healthy debate to have had? And do you feel optimistic about the future? Or do you just think this is a sign of how difficult things are now and the level of scrutiny that are on MPs?
Well, I don't think that enhanced scrutiny of MPs is a bad thing. I think actually it's a good thing. It keeps us on our toes and makes sure that it focuses our minds. And ultimately, I'd like to think that it helps improve governance in general. However, if to address your question directly, I think that it was perhaps important to have the debate. The timing perhaps was fortuitous or otherwise, depending on your point of view. But I think it was probably a debate that was coming down the line. And now that we've had it, I think things will improve. Even if there aren't any substantial, meaningful changes, I think there will be behavioural changes that will remain. And I think that speaking to some colleagues, you had that behavioural effect after 2010 expenses scandal and then the formation of IPSA. So I do think that on balance, it would be a good thing.
Peter, coming to you, obviously another of the themes here has been the need for cross-party support in terms of whatever is the route forward. Do you feel confident that that's happening now behind the scenes, that we, you know, the parties will come together to decide on the next steps?
But yeah, simply the answer is yes, because they need to and they'll want to. The problem is if you start making things too party managed and too outside invigilated, and people sort of start losing the fact that being an MP is a pretty undefined opportunity of doing roughly what you like within certain boundaries. Those boundaries may change, they may suddenly pop up, they may suddenly disappear. The outrageous can get away with things. And you don't want to have a parliament that's full of church mice and flashers. You want to have the person who's ordinarily embarrassed if they're seen without their clothes on. I think that I would argue for the ordinary embarrassed type of person having the opportunity of getting in, staying in if they can, and having as much fun as they can. The other thing is, don't go judging people by what they look like or sound like. My last job before Parliament was putting neon lights outside theatres and cinemas in the West End. And one of the reasons why I persisted in trying to get into Parliament was when the Prime Minister patted me on the back saying, plucky man, not proof by off by the idea of more bombs and all this debris. And I thought, I wasn't worried about the bombs. It's working outside with high voltage electricity at heights when I get dizzy by sound and my dignity. He's an MP. He doesn't need a raincoat. He's indoor job, no heavy lifting. Become an MP, it's an easy life. And I still think it's pretty good life.
Marie, final thought, just we've only got a minute or two left, but do you have optimism for the role of MPs? Is the public's perception going to change?
Not massively. I think, you know, the most powerful force in politics is entropy. So I suspect that we'll have forgotten most about that debate in about 3 to 5 weeks. But I want to be hopeful. And I do think that basically I'm not certain that everything's going to change suddenly tomorrow. But I do think it's a conversation that's now started that hopefully will sort of rumble on in the background for the next 2 years. And hopefully by the next election, we'll have come closer to some sort of new definition. Hopefully, perhaps.
Yeah, you segue brilliantly to my question then to Tim. Is this going to be an issue at the next election?
I don't think it's going to decide the next election at all. I mean, I think, you know, people have always been pretty sceptical, not to say cynical, about MPs. There was no great golden age, you know, research suggests. So I think when it comes to elections, this will probably be a thing of the past and people will vote as they always do on issues, on their own personal economic circumstances and on their, you know, views of the parties.
All right. Thank you all. It's been a fascinating debate. I'm sure if nothing else, we will keep considering the role of MPs and considering how the public can understand it better. My thanks to Tim Bale, Marie LeConte, Sir Peter Bottomley and Ben Lake. And thank you all for joining us. If you're not got enough of IFG, you can join us again tomorrow, where our 25th Data Bites is going to be getting things done with data in government. And we've got a couple of people from Downing Street who can talk about how they're using data there. So do join tomorrow at 6 o'clock. Thank you all.